If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. And we've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone here at the Antioch Baptist Church for our homecoming 2021. Yeah. That's right. We couldn't have one last year. It's a lot better to get back together this year, isn't it? So, if we do happen to have any visitors here, I'd like to ask you to please fill out your visitor card that's in front of you and just put it in the offering plate as it comes around. I only have one other announcement, and I'm going to turn everything over to everybody else. If you are looking to make a donation to the Antioch Baptist Church Cemetery Association, there's a bucket in the back, and you can make your check payable to the Antioch Baptist Cemetery Fund. Not the Antioch Baptist Church, it's a little bit different now. But any other donations into the regular offering boxes will go to the church itself. I told them I'd be short to get their fingers ready, so I'm very done. The only other thing I want to do is welcome our guest pastor today. I guess you call him a guest pastor. He's born and bred right here in Antioch Baptist Church, and he can pretty much introduce himself, but we do want to welcome Anthony Clore for the message this morning. Okay. Thank y'all.
Now we got an announcement video this morning, and after that, y'all can hop up on your feet and we'll get to worshiping this morning.
Standing in your ruins feels a lot like the end. So used to losing, you're afraid to try again. Right now all you see are ashes where there was a flame. Truth is that you're not forgotten, 'cause grace knows your name. God's not done. Your broken heart and your wounds and your scars. God's not done with you. Even when you're lost and it's hard and you're falling apart. God's not done with you. It's not over, it's only begun. So don't hide, don't run. 'Cause God's not done. There's a light you don't notice until you're standing in the dark. And there's a strength that's growing inside your shattered heart. Whoa. God's not done with you. Even with your broken heart and your wounds and your scars. God's not done with you. Even when you're lost and it's hard and you're falling. So don't hide, don't run, 'cause God's not done with you, you. He's got a plan, this is part of it. He's gonna finish what he started. He's got a plan, this is part of it. He's gonna finish what he started.
not done. God's not done writing your story. No, he's not done.
Going on. Sunday, August 22nd, will be a baby dedication service. Please contact the church office if you wish to have your child or infant dedicated on that day. Men, if you're interested in going to a men's Ignite conference at Thomas Road Baptist Church, please contact the church office to register. If you like to fish, then Saturday, August 21st is going to be your day. There will be a fishing tournament and gathering at Bear Creek Lake State Park. That's it. Enjoy the service.
If y'all want to hop up on your feet, we get to worshiping. I was supposed to say something this morning about toddler church and nursery and kids alive. My wife told me to tell you, but I wasn't paying attention. But I was close.
Swallowed by pride. Put out of the darkness, you brought me to your light. You showed me new mercy and opened up my eyes. From the day you saved my soul,
give it up for the Lord this morning.
Broken rainbow.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Lord, we love you, Lord. It's such a blessing to be in your house this morning, gathered with our family and friends, Lord. But we just ask that you look after us this week, Lord. Look after us forever, Lord. You are the King. Just bless this offering today, Lord. Use it in your kingdom as you see fit. Lord, we love you and praise your name. Amen.
That are shaken and stirred.
All right, let's put our hands together this morning and welcome a good friend, a family member to Antioch, Mr. Anthony Clore.
Amen. Thank you, brother. Can we give it up for the worship band this morning? Man. It's amazing how the time of worship, if we just allow it, really prepares us for hearing the word. Amen is correct. I want to just start out by telling everybody how much I'm appreciative and how thankful I am for being here this morning. I was just sitting there thinking while I was singing and worshiping, and I was thinking, you know, what's the old saying? It takes a village to raise a child, right? But it takes a church to raise a Christ follower. And I'm thankful for this church. As I look through the history of the church, and I got to grow up here, and I saw, you know, my grandparents and my parents, and some of you that are just like second parents to me, I'm so thankful for your faithfulness to invest in my life so that I would hear the preaching and the teaching of God's word, that I would sing, spiritual songs here in this place, that I would have Sunday school and VBS, all the work that goes into it. Now that I'm a pastor, I realize all the work that goes into it. And I realize all the work that all the volunteers do, the people that just come and serving out of their heart. And it takes the whole church to raise up a pastor or a disciple or just a Christ follower. And so I'm thankful for this church this morning. I'm so thankful to be back. And I told Jenny when we were pulling in, it's like we're just going to church this morning, but it's not. It's weird, you know. And so I know my kids really wanted to be here today. But we just finished up a week of VBS, and so if I look like I've had a rough week, I have. But they're actually doing a presentation, and they're helping lead, and Lily's in the song singing and stuff, so they couldn't be here today. But anyways, if you got your Bibles with you this morning, we'll get started. Matthew chapter 13, if you want to find that, and just go to verse 53, and we're going to stay there. And when you read the actual, you know, title over this, if in your Bible, you start looking at the story, it's probably a familiar couple of verses. You're going to be like, oh my goodness, where is he going with this? You know, but what kind of homecoming sermon are we in for? But the title of the sermon is Why Jesus is Rejected. So before I get started this morning, I want to give us a little background into how the Lord laid this message on my heart for you today. See, I've been doing a study for almost 2 years now, verse by verse, following Jesus' life and ministry through the Gospel of Matthew. I love it. It's my favorite gospel. I love them all, but I really love, if I'm stressed out or I'm going through something or if I just need to get with the Lord, I always go back to Matthew. It's just one of my favorites. A lot of my life verses are in there. And so a few months ago when I was studying this passage back in May, as soon as I started studying it to teach it to the church that I get to pastor now here at Fork Union Baptist, the Lord said, this is what you're going to preach at homecoming. And I had the same thought. I said, what? How does that apply to a homecoming service? So the whole time I was praying and studying for this part of the scripture, I kept thinking about how hurt Jesus must have been when he was rejected by his hometown. And I began to think, what if I came back home for homecoming and everyone rejected me? How would I feel? Which you haven't. You've been very welcoming. Thank goodness. And I didn't expect to be rejected. I'm not saying that. How would I feel if I came back to my hometown to share what God was doing in my ministry? How would I feel? And it made me think of how Jesus must have felt what he should feel every time that we reject him, and every time we reject his calling, every time we reject him wanting to do something new in our life, or maybe just to pick up our cross and follow him. How does Jesus feel when he calls us into a deeper relationship with him and we push him aside? When the Holy Spirit starts working, we've all done it, we've all felt it, and we go, not right now, God, not right now. How does Jesus feel when he calls us to live a holy life and to rid ourselves of the sin that we're tangled up in? How does Jesus feel when he calls us to be redeemed and accept his grace and his mercy and forgiveness that he paid with his life for on the cross, and we simply refuse to surrender it all to him? So even when I was studying this passage for our study of Matthew at Fork Union Baptist, the Lord confirmed that this passage is what we needed to hear today here in my hometown and my family at Fork Union Baptist, at Antioch Baptist Church. So this morning, We're going to see Jesus returning to his hometown of Nazareth. And if you've already found the scripture there, Jesus being Jesus, I love saying that because he's all everywhere he goes, he's always doing the same thing. He begins to what? He begins to preach the word of God. And he starts performing miracles. He starts helping people. Now, at first, the people were amazed by his wisdom. And we're going to read it here in just a few seconds. They were amazed. They said, where does he get all this power? How can he do this? But it didn't take long for the people to start doing what people always do. Instead of accepting Jesus, instead of listening to Jesus, instead of experiencing Jesus' power work in their life, they begin to question his authority. Wait a minute. Who is he to tell me I need to live like this? Who is he to tell me this? They begin to take offense at the teachings. They didn't like what he was saying because it didn't make them comfortable. And they ultimately rejected him. So why did his hometown reject him? Well, this passage is going to tell us three reasons that jumped out at me. And number one is this. They lacked understanding of Jesus and who he was. Number two, they were offended by Jesus. And number three, they simply refused to believe. So let's read the scripture and let God's word tell us this morning and speak to us. Matthew 13, 53 through 58. It says this. When Jesus had finished telling these stories and illustrations, he left that part of the country. He returned to Nazareth, his hometown. When he taught there in the synagogue, everyone was amazed and said, where does he get his wisdom and the power to do miracles? Then they scoffed. He's just a carpenter's son. And we know Mary, his mother, and his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. All of his sisters live right here among us. Where did he learn all these things? And they were deeply offended and refused to believe in him. Then Jesus told them, a prophet is honored everywhere except in his own hometown and among his own family. So he did only a few miracles there because of their unbelief. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we just thank you for the reading of your word. And Lord, we thank you for the fact that's been proven over and over, that's been proven in my life, that I can testify to today, that when we simply take your word that's living and it's going to last forever, that was inspired by you, and we take the words and we take the events that you recorded for us, that you breathed into this Bible, and we simply say, I'm going to become a doer of the word, and I'm going to let God's word enter into my life and enter in the depths of who I am and in my soul. We know that you go to work and you find fertile soil there, great soil that's suitable for the seed that you want to plant. And so God, I don't know who's got what going on with their heart this morning. Lord, some people they've got that seed that or that soil that the seed can't even take root in. Lord, some of the people that are here today, maybe they've got fertile soil and their heart is ready and you're already growing their life and you just want to grow them more and you want to put some water on it today and you make it grow. But maybe there's those who just need to open up for the first time and let that seed get planted. God, we pray through your Holy Spirit, not through the words that I speak, but through your words, that you can speak to us today and change our lives and make us to be more like you so we really can have that life and life more abundant. Lord, we love you again, and I thank you for this opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So here's Jesus, if you want to look back in the scriptures, coming home to share the teachings that God had sent him to the world to teach to those that he loved in his very own hometown, his family. This is where he was raised as a child. I can't imagine having a little kid Jesus running around the town. It always is one of those like questions you think, when I get to heaven, I'm going to ask God, because we know Jesus didn't sin, right? But did he ever get in trouble like as a child? I mean, he was running around. He was a child. We know he's fully person he was fully God. But these are some of the questions that I think of. But this is where he grew up, and he learned the trade of being a carpenter from his dad, and this is where he once called his home. And I think about all my precious memories here at my home at Antioch Baptist Church. And I had no idea that they were going to share some of those pictures that I happened to be in. But some of the things that happened in those pictures, like the roof on the front part of this building anyways, I was about 13 years old, and I remember some of my best memories is standing up there with an Ace Hardware, one of those cloth nail aprons, and really feeling like a man because I was helping some of the guys and the deacons and the builders put on the roof and the tar paper up on top of the church. helping my grandfather paint the old, what we call now the chapel, the original building, coming up in the summers and just sitting with him out at the picnic shelter while he was taking a lunch break. The old homecoming services out at that old picnic shelter where I got to enjoy Francis Johnson's goulash. Dave would say, "Come on, somebody." And there's even a picture of me that I'm thinking, God, it wasn't up there, that somebody has that I've seen, even since I'm an adult, of me peeing off the front steps of the church when I was about 5 years old. That wasn't right before I left. So from VBS to Sunday school to all the pastors that have served here, the pastor that's serving now, the youth group that I attended here, this is where I gave my life to Christ. Here, at this place. This is where I began to grow in my relationship with Christ. And ultimately, it's where I surrendered to the ministry of Christ. I remember standing up in front of many of you that are here today at a tent revival, and I said, today I'm standing up and I'm saying I am surrendering to the ministry and where God calls me, I'm going to go. And I want you to hold me accountable. And guess what? You did. Even when I really wasn't so sure about it. And God is so good. But this is where I preached my very first sermon. And I think I just cried the whole time. And I remember somebody telling me, like, man, if you can never stop crying the whole time, you actually might make a decent preacher one day. You see, Jesus loved the people there. And he loved his family that was there. And I'm not saying that I'm like Jesus. I'm not comparing myself to Jesus. I'm just trying to put myself in his shoes as he was a man returning to his hometown. How would I feel if I was in Jesus's place? And how does he feel now when we reject him? See, he knew they also needed a Savior. He longed to be and to help those and to go preach to the ones he rubbed shoulders with for the first like early 30 part of his life. But his welcome was short-lived and he was rejected. So why was Jesus rejected in his hometown? And how can it relate to us? That's what we're going to talk about this morning. So let's go back through this passage and we're going to see. And we're going to read it again because sometimes we can get caught up in reading the scripture and we just hear it. But I want us to really listen this morning to the Word of God. Matthew 13, let's read 53 through 56 and we'll talk about it. When Jesus had finished telling these stories and illustrations, he left that part of the country. He returned to Nazareth, his hometown. When he taught there in the synagogues, everyone was amazed and said, "Where does he get this wisdom to do power and power to do these miracles?" Then they scoffed, "He's just a carpenter's son. And I know Mary, his mother, and his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. All of his sisters live right here among us. Where did he learn all these things?" So right here in these first few verses, we see the first reason why they rejected. The people simply did not understand Christ. They didn't understand why he came. They didn't understand his power. They didn't understand really what he was all about. They lacked understanding. Jesus was rejected in his hometown because the people did not understand who he really was. They didn't understand the source of his wisdom. They didn't understand the source of his power. See, Jesus didn't have a robe, like a fancy robe and a priest, the thing that the priests would wear around their neck and all those. He didn't have all that. He didn't have an ordination certificate. He didn't have a seminary degree. Instead, he just came from those simple, humble beginnings in the town of Nazareth. His father was a carpenter. His mother was a housewife. They had seen him their entire lives running around the town in the streets and just being a kid. And they didn't understand who he really was and the source of his wisdom and his power. I believe there's somebody here today, maybe many people, that can relate to the Nazarenes this morning. You've heard the name of Jesus your whole life. Maybe you've seen pictures of the cross, or you've got a necklace with the cross on, or maybe you've seen a cross at every church corner in America. Maybe you've got a picture in your home of what we think Jesus looked like. But you're here today and you're lacking understanding of Jesus and his real power, what he can really do in your life. You're lacking that understanding. And that's okay if you are, because we were all there at once. I remember being there. And if you're honest with yourself today, just like the people in Nazareth, you have rejected Christ because you lack understanding. You really reject him because you don't understand what he has for you. The people of Jerusalem, the religious leaders, they did the same thing. There was God, the very God that they went to the temple and gave sacrifices to, and all the things they did, all these religious laws they tried to keep. And there's God himself standing right there in front of them. the very Messiah that they predicted would come, as they read in the law that they knew would come. All the prophets had said about was standing right in front of them, and they didn't recognize him. Acts chapter 13, verse 27 says this: the people in Jerusalem and their leaders did not recognize Jesus as the ones the prophet had spoke about. Instead, they condemned him. And in doing this, they fulfilled the prophets' words that they read every Sabbath. So they went and preached and read the scrolls every week in the synagogues of all the things and the Messiah that was to come. And here he was standing in front of them, and they rejected him. See, this is their human nature. We reject that in which we cannot understand. If it doesn't fit into our little finite, like in our simple mind, if you're like me, I'm simple-minded, okay? If I can't understand it, if I can't wrap my brain around it, it's our natural reaction to say, I don't want nothing to do with that, because I don't understand that. So why do we reject Christ? Number one is because we lack understanding, and that's why the people of Nazareth rejected him. Look at verse 57, and we'll keep going. It says this: and they were deeply offended and refused to believe in him. Then Jesus told them, a prophet is honored everywhere except in his hometown and among his own people. So here in this one verse, we see the second reason that we so often reject Jesus Christ. We reject him because we're offended by Christ. Now, I know you're probably thinking, what do you mean we're offended by Christ? So here is Jesus, the same Jesus that grew up in this town, a man who ate and drank and worked and slept among all the people, right here that he's going back to visit and claiming to be the Son of God. He had no right to claim he was the Son of God to those people. They're like, what are you talking about? You're just Jesus, the kid that ran around the streets. He had no right to call himself the Messiah. See, this kind of rejection followed him his entire ministry here on earth. If you think about it, how many times did he go places and do mighty miracles and actually got ran off? At one point, they tried to run him off of a cliff, and God made a way for him to slip through the crowd. Even while he was hanging on the cross, the people rejected him. Why? Because they were offended by him. We often do this because we are offended. Mark chapter 15, verse 31 and 32 says this: the leading priests and the teachers of religious law also mocked Jesus. He saved others, they scoffed, but he can't save himself. Mind you, he's hanging on the cross. Hanging on the cross, dying for their sins. He saved others, but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross so we can see it and believe in him. Even the men who were crucified with Jesus ridiculed him. You see, they lacked understanding of who he was, and they were offended at his claim to be who he really was. And again, church, more than likely, there's somebody here today that has been rejecting Christ because they're offended by him. And I can hear somebody thinking these words, or maybe even kind of thinking, whispering to themselves, oh, preacher, but if I was offended by God's word, if I was offended by Jesus' message, why would I be here today? I wouldn't be here today. Well, I can tell you right now, we're happy that you're here. I'm happy to be here. But being here doesn't save your soul. Amen? It's hearing and believing that saves your soul. It's believing and repenting and turning to Christ. It's repenting and following Christ that saves your soul. You see, we don't like when our sins are brought into the light. And that's what Jesus does in our life. Now, he's there ready with open arms, but he exposes that sin in their life. The word tells us that he shines light into the darkness. It's not to condemn us, it's to bring us into the light. And when the Holy Spirit begins to convict me of the sin that I need to get rid of and I need to repent of, or maybe I need to forgive somebody that I don't think deserves my forgiveness, maybe the Holy Spirit is calling me to give my finances to the Lord and maybe start tithing and giving a portion back to him. Boy, I'll tell you what, that one will offend you real quick. That's my money, God. You don't have any right to that. That's my money. Or maybe the Holy Spirit is just calling you into a deeper commitment to Christ like he did in my life here at this church. Either way, when the Holy Spirit begins speaking truth into our lives, we get offended. And so the first thing we do when we get offended, we want to get away from it, right? If somebody offends us, we want to separate ourselves from them. So when we get offended by God's word, when we get offended by Jesus, when we get offended when the Holy Spirit starts crushing and convicting our heart, we reject Christ. See, all too often we get uncomfortable and we don't like it when the Lord Jesus comes in wanting to change our life. But God, I'm comfortable. I'm comfortable at Antioch Baptist. We've got a thriving youth group and I'm a part of this awesome worship band. God, I just want to stay here. Why do you want me to go there? We don't like it at first. But there's no sweeter place to be than in God's will. And if God, no matter what God is calling you to do, whether it's walk away from sin, whether it's to step into a new ministry, whether it's just to give your life to Him today, it's the sweetest spot you'll ever find. We have to believe. We have to believe this morning. This brings us right to the last reason that Jesus is rejected. Look at verse 58 with me. And we're going to stay here for just a few minutes. And so He did only a few miracles there because of their unbelief. I really don't even have to preach on this, but I'm going to anyways because it says it right there. So here's the third and final reason that Jesus is rejected. The people refused to believe. Think about all the things, the great things that Christ did that we read about in the New Testament. All the things that He did. Simply, He said, your faith has healed you. Your faith has cleansed you. Oh, ye of little faith, if you would only believe. See, remember, this is the same Christ that was born of a virgin that we celebrate in Christmas time in Matthew chapter 1. It's the same Jesus that John the Baptist spoke about and that the God spoke from heaven, the dove descended down on Him when He was baptized in Matthew chapter 3. It's the same Jesus who defeated the temptation of Satan in the wilderness in Matthew chapter 4. You see where we're going here? The same Jesus that traveled all over the place healing every kind of sickness and disease. Chapter 5, He preached the best sermon ever preached on the mount. He taught us how to pray in Matthew 6 and how not to worry about things. Put it all in perspective. Matthew chapter 8, He healed many people. A man with leprosy, the young servant of the Roman officer, Peter's mother-in-law. Many demon-possessed people were set free. He even calmed the storm and walked on water. In Matthew 9, Jesus healed a paralyzed man, the daughter of a synagogue leader. The blind man could see, and another demon-possessed man was set free. In chapter 12, Jesus healed the man with a deformed hand. It goes on and on. In fact, John told us in chapter 21 of John, he said, if we recorded everything that Jesus did, there would be no book that can contain it all. This is just a few. Over and over, God continued to show us who Jesus is. I love Romans chapter 1. It tells us that you can't look around at all creation. I'm paraphrasing. You can't look outside of God's creation and say there is no God. You can't look at a newborn baby and say, there's no way that God didn't create that baby in the mother's womb. God continues to show us where Jesus gets His wisdom. Over and over, God continues to show us where Jesus gets His power. Yet so many people, I'm among them, have been among them, simply refuse to believe. You know, every Sunday at church, at my church, I show up with the thoughts, nobody's going to come today. God, You've called me down here, and are You really going to be with me today? Even though over the last 3 years, He's never let me down. I still doubt Him, and I refuse to believe. And when we refuse to believe, what happens is we miss out on the miracles that Jesus wants to do in our lives. So sometimes it's okay, and I'm learning that. It's okay for me to have ye of little faith. But the difference is, it's kind of like courage. You know, the difference between courage, is what makes courage so great is that it doesn't mean you can't be scared. It just means you step up and you say, I'm scared to death, but I'm still going to do it. So even though I may not believe God can do the things He can do in my life, I still step up and I do it. That's what I'm learning. Just like the people in Nazareth, we miss out on the miracles that Jesus wants to do in our life when we do not believe. There's somebody here today, maybe many people here today, that have been rejecting Jesus because they think that their unbelief is holding them back, or maybe their unbelief is holding them back. Maybe you've been rejecting Him because you are having a hard time understanding who Christ really is and how he could really love you the way His Word tells us that He loves you. How could He love me, and how would He really give His life for me, and how would his blood really cover my sin? You don't understand what I've done, preacher. You don't understand. Oh, believe me, I probably do, because I'm human too. Amen? Or maybe you've rejected Jesus because you're having a hard time just simply believing. Don't leave here today without crying out to God from your heart, because he will show you today exactly, and He will confirm in your heart where He gets His wisdom and power comes, because you can't explain it. You can't explain it. So I want to leave you with this morning as the worship band comes back up. Every time we reject Christ, and I want us to really think about this, you're hurting the following. Number one is this: you hurt yourself. Every time you reject Christ, you hurt yourself. You have an abundant life waiting for you in Christ. And when you reject Him, you're rejecting that new life, that newness of life, that freedom that comes from following Christ. John chapter 3, verse 18 says this: "There is no judgment against anyone who believes in Him. But anyone who does not believe has already been judged for not believing." See, there's that word believing again. For not believing in God's one and only Son. Number two, when we reject Christ, we're robbing our family, our hometown, our friends, our children, and our grandchildren of the testimony that they need to hear about what Christ has done in your life. So if I reject Christ, I'm hurting the future generations, and I'm hurting my friends and my family, because they need the testimony. We just sang about it, right? That scripture tells us that there's power in our testimony. That's how we overcome, by the blood of the Lamb and our testimony. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15 and 16 says this. This is a trustworthy saying, and everyone should accept it. This is Paul writing this. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and I am the worst of them all. But God had mercy on me, so that Christ Jesus could use me as a prime example of His great patience with even the worst sinners. Then others will realize that they too can believe in Him and receive eternal life. That's what's so powerful about people seeing Anthony Clore preaching in his hometown. Whether it's in Fork Union, people know in Fork Union how I used to live, right? But see, God wants to use that. He wants to use that to show His great patience with even Anthony Clore. Then others too will realize that they can believe in Him. You're hurting other people, and you're hurting your neighbors, and you're hurting your loved ones when you reject Christ. And number three, when you reject Christ, you actually hurt Jesus Christ Himself. I love Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. Jesus said, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." Did you know that Christ longs to give you rest for your soul? Do you know that when I gave my life to Christ, when I really got serious and I said, "God, I'm ready," do you know how much rest my soul has had since then? My body hadn't had much rest, but my soul is at rest, and I sleep good at night because all of my shame, all my guilt, all that was nailed to the cross with Christ. Christ wants to give you a new start today. Christ wants to stand with you day by day and help you fulfill your purpose and the calling that He has for you, the reason He created you in your mother's womb. And Christ longs to have you with Him for all eternity. That's something we got to believe this morning. John 14:2 says this, and I promise we're closing. Jesus said, "There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you?" Jesus has prepared a place for you this morning. Why have you been rejecting Jesus? I don't care if you've been a Christian for years. God doesn't care if you've been a Christian for years. Why have you been rejecting Him? In what area have you been rejecting Christ? Is it because you lack understanding? Is it because you're offended by Him? Is it because of you just struggle with your faith and your unbelief? Take it from someone who did it for years. You can be a Christian, right, and still reject Christ. If you're tired of that and you're ready for that rest for your soul, and you're ready to give Christ those burdens and those heavy burdens, and you're ready for that rest for your souls today, that's what this time of invitation is for. I would be glad to pray with you this morning. I would be glad to share some of my story with you later. I would be glad to just be with you while you pray. Whatever God is calling you this morning, as the band plays, as we sing this song, don't leave here today rejecting Christ, no matter what it is and the reason it is. Give your life to Christ and you'll find rest for your soul. Amen? Amen.
Through it all,
standing around you. If you want to put your hands in the air and worship the Lord this morning, He's here. Oh, He's here. He's waiting for us to make that decision.
So thankful this morning for the Holy Spirit. Can somebody testify with me this morning that we're happy? I want to encourage us to remember that the Holy Spirit, God promises He gave us the Holy Spirit to seal us. And the devil might try to mess with us. The devil might try to pull us away for a while. But God's Spirit still dwells in us. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in us if we've called on the name of Jesus. And so we have to believe that today, and we have to stand on that, and we have to go back to it. There's so many times that I have to go back to that commitment that I made right here. Well, it was in the other building, but right here at Antioch when I gave my life to Christ. And I have to say, no, devil, no, you did call me, and I remember that. I remember those times of just getting into your word and remembering. So sometimes we have to go back to that place where it all started with Christ to remember who God really called us to be. And so I want to encourage you to do that today. Before we close in prayer, I want to tell you this. I can't stay for the dinner, which I am deeply offended by that. But we have one of our longtime, just loved church members passed away this week. And I've got a funeral that I've got to get back and do this afternoon. So I would appreciate your prayers for me and her family to get through that. But I also want to tell you this, and Travis told me that don't forget that before we close, that before you start packing the chairs up, that we've got a really, really short meeting, and then we're gonna pack up and start eating. Amen? So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we love you. And Lord, again, we just thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you that, Lord, you gave your life for us. Lord, that even when you were in human form walking here on this earth, you were always ready to preach God's word. You're always ready to teach us and make a lesson for us so we could learn what really you want from us. God, help us not to reject you. Lord, if there's somebody here today that was rejecting you like I did for so many years and so many church services and so many invitations, Lord, I pray that they would, if nothing else, that they would go home and get alone with you and just really let you into their life and work in their heart and give them rest for their souls. Lord, we love you, and I just thank you for this opportunity again. I thank you for calling me to a life of following you, and I thank you for those who encourage me along the way.
here at this precious body of believers called Antioch. Lord, I just pray for the church to continue to grow and to prosper. Lord, I pray for Pastor Dave and his family to get rest this week as they're gone, but also that you would continue to work in their life and in their ministry, that you would continue to bless them. Right now, as they are resting or wherever they are, that they would feel your presence, just pouring out your blessing on them. Lord, we love you and we praise you again. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless.
Hello, my name's Dave, and I'm the pastor here at Antioch Baptist Church. I just want to thank you for joining us for this time of praise and worship. I hope that it impacted your life and that it inspired you to take your relationship with God to the next level. If you were watching today and you felt convicted by the Lord to accept Christ as Savior and Lord of your life, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Just say, "Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need you to make me new. I invite you into my life to be my Lord and to be my master. I believe that you rose from the dead, and I believe that you are the Son of God, and I believe that you will return to the earth again to take me home to be with you. Jesus, thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying for my sin. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. Amen." If you prayed that prayer and if you responded to that message today, we'd love to hear about it. I want you to contact us here at the church and let us know about the impact that it's had on your life so that we can celebrate with you and so that we can give you some resources to help you in furthering your walk with Jesus. Thank you so much for tuning in. God bless you. And remember to love, connect, go, and grow.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to feel